coming tonight to NFA for the second budget forum to discuss the 2013-2014 school district budget. Tonight's forum will run for approximately 2 hours. The board will reserve a half hour at the end of tonight's session for public input to suggest ways of reducing the budget. These suggestions should also be written in written form and sent to the district clerk for review by the staff and Board of Education. They may also be submitted through our district website. Please contact the district clerk as we will allow these requesting to speak on a first come, first served basis. I will let you know that we have, the district clerk has not received any request to speak, so it will be this evening on a first come, first served as you step up to the microphones that have been set up in the front of the auditorium. This is not a time to voice concerns about the possible cuts that you may hear under discussion this evening by the board and the central administration. We truly understand that the reduction will have an impact on our district. However, it's our charge to follow the guidelines set up by the New York State law regarding the property tax cap. The opportunity to voice your concerns over the cuts may still take place at the regularly scheduled monthly board meeting, which happens to during the public discussion on non-agenda items. This public board meeting for February will be taking place this coming Tuesday, February 26th at 7 p.m. We will be hosting that at Temple Hill Academy with the anticipation of a large audience. We want to make sure that we have enough time and enough space for everyone that wants to be there and listen and have an opportunity for public comment to be able to do so. At the last budget workshop, we also, I was asked a question about the suggestions that come in to the district and to the board members about possible ways to reduce the budget, how they might be shared, and I believe, Mr. Pacella, that you were able to get them up on the website, so we share that. So that information is on the website. So I appreciate that input and suggestion, and I look forward to more positive suggestions coming our way. So at this time, we'll get started, and I will turn it over to the superintendent, Mr. Pisa.
Thank you, Madam President. Again, let me say welcome to those people in the audience who came to help us with our budget this year. Mr. Pacella and the central office team has worked very hard and diligently through a very difficult period of time to put together a budget that serves the taxpayers of the district, serves the employees of the district, but most of all, serves the students that we serve on a daily basis. So I'd like to turn it over to Mike Pacella right now. Michael.
Thanks, Mr. Pacella. I think you should take time to mention that all the building principals and directors had a lot to do with the input and some of the information that will be disseminated tonight. I know that Mr. Forge and his team of the building principals spent at least 3 days worth of exploring their programs, their enrollment figures, so that should be mentioned also. So we know where we are. As I mentioned last budget meeting, we're looking for roughly $9.8 million. You have two folders, one that was given to you at the workshop for you to review for tonight, and then one that was handed out today because you were inquiring about additional information. Most of that information is in the second one, and in the memo, you'll see that. There is one piece that I didn't have time to get, we're working on that. I should have it to you by Tuesday night, and that's the listing of the salaries with all the extra earnings. So I'll provide that to you on Tuesday night. So I'll take you through your main packet that you received Tuesday, and I'll read through the memo of each particular item, but I just want to go through briefly the items that you received. You requested the past 2 years worth of reductions. So you have 2011, 2012, and 2012-13 that was adopted by you, the board. Then you have the extra earnings budget line by line. Two-page document. current year budget status report. We wanted to compare the current year expenses versus the budget that was approved in 2013. And then you have the current year summary, the proposed summary of the changes. Now, in your current folder that's on your right in front of you tonight, there's an updated, revised summary because a couple lines were, did you get a folder more? There's a revised spreadsheet. I should say revised right across the top of it. I need to use this one for the guidelines tonight and disregard the one that was in your packet for Tuesday night because there's a couple of line items added. And then to get into your schedules, beginning with A, and that's where we'll take it from. Before we get into A, first couple items on the spreadsheet to be reductions or increases to the budget. This is where we'll put the memo. The elementary security positions. In order to staff the elementary schools with full-time monitors without affecting the budget, the following schools are recommended to be reduced. The MFA main campus will go down 2 full-time security. The North campus will go down 1. And then 1 each at Heritage, South, Temple Hill, and Meadowhill. The Hill schools may require a part-time position to supplement the loss of the additional 1 will be used at the current or extra earnings budget. These reductions are being recommended to minimize costs. We believe there will be deficiencies in some of the schools, but we'll try to manage as best as possible. What needs to be discussed, but we did not discuss, is the continuation of the community resource officer here at NFA.
Mr. Purcell, that position is currently mostly funded through a grant, correct?
Some, for this year.
For this year?
12-13.
We're not sure about next year?
Correct. At this time.
It's the school violence prevention grant. I believe Ms. Dixon says 70,000 of the 100,000 is funded through the school violence prevention. Sorry, we're going to have discussion on this.
I need to know the board's wishes on if they want to have a full-time security monitor in each elementary school for next year with this as the parameters. We did discuss the vestibule and the ID security system, mm-hmm. and that is, we still plan on going forward with that. We're hoping to get that done either by June or at least through the summer.
And that the vestibules that have to be done will be funded through the capital project.
Well, we have to talk to Armin and Damon to make sure that there is capacity within the prior proposition.
Okay. Comment? So this would be the 7 elementary security that we put back last year, this would be using existing positions.
Right.
So that, because that was, if I remember 2 weeks ago, it was going to be an additional 700,000 if we were to add the 7 positions for the next school year.
Correct. And with the security director, the director of security, the district in consultation with some of the buildings and the lead up here at NFA, they think that they should be able to handle it. Again, it's not something that you know until it actually happens.
So the plan would be to take these that are coming out of here and place them in the elementary buildings.
If that's what it's for.
Yes, Prokash.
If that's a possible scenario for next year, then would it be possible, because you're saying we're spending $700,000 additional this year, correct?
Well, that would be for the full year. That's not what we're spending this year.
For the rest of this year, then we are spending
Well, the rest of this year, the union agreed to do a per diem for June, so it's a fraction of what we would have spent.
Okay. Otherwise, I would have said, you know, try it out
this year,
like after spring break for the rest of the year, by redeploying, then you'll have a general idea, you know.
Well, I can tell you that the reason why this came up, because we're experiencing a high amount of attendance problems at the security level. So the schools are running with one or two less right now. It's very difficult to fill by subs, especially because a lot of the subs have secured those per diem spots at the elementary school. So we're basically running right now with this scenario based on attendance. Unfortunately, you have to pay the full-time people who are out. So we recognize that we possibly can do this. That's why we're recommending it for next year.
Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
I'd like to back up a step. I thought back before Christmas, we were talking about a security evaluation that was going to come forward to us. And that would, I would think, it had included this. In other words, what were the things that were being recommended by central administration? We need this, we need this, we need this. And I don't think we ever really received that report. We've talked about bits and pieces of it.
No, you received an assessment needs. You've received an assessment report by security director regarding each elementary school. I don't have it with me, but I can certainly give you another copy of it. That was handed out.
But I thought I was going to be getting something from you and the computer. And I guess that's what I was waiting for.
I think what you're referring to, Mrs. McAfee, is the continuation of and other security measures in the wake of
just the security guards.
Right.
So, but the vestibules that you mentioned, right. What we were going to do, and it would be a package recommendation. And that's why I said it would have included the discussion of the security guards, and I realized that. But that's what, I thought I was waiting for.
I can get you a copy of that assessment, and that's what we based all this on. The one that was handed out,
it was right before we put the security guards back in place in the way, because we had done it temporarily till January 22nd, so the January 22nd workshop is when this report.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And something that would be coming not from the NFA head of security.
It didn't. It means it says it came from the director of security. Mr. Young.
John Young.
After a visit to each elementary school.
And that has been checked by you. So it's coming forward through.
Yes.
If you could give me another copy.
Sure.
Because right now, I don't know where to put that.
Okay.
And in addition to that, as Mr. Pacella said, there'll have to be more discussions with the capital project team around the vestibule work to make sure that the funds are there. So, that would be coming forward also, but obviously not affecting the general fund budget, but that would also be a piece of the security moving forward. So this is a piece around the security guards, but there'll be more information coming forward with additional pieces that wouldn't be affected in the general fund.
And you understand where my question
is? Yes. Yes. Yes.
That at this point, I'm not sure that we have made a decision that we do think that elementary security guards are required until we see, and talk about the.
And I think that this putting this out there was part of the reason to generate that discussion, Mrs. McAfee, about what the board's feelings were on, keeping those seven elementary positions at, of those, or keeping those seven guards in the elementary schools. Mr. Levinstein.
We have what's being reduced in each building. What is the amount that's there now? So how many are being reduced? I know that there's one and then two. How many is there now?
What are the totals?
What is the total for each building?
I I don't have the exact total with me, I can give that to you. I know the Hill Schools have three. The NFA North has six. I believe the main campus has 24 on three separate shifts. Well, the one out of three, remember, the Hill Schools are K-8, so at least half that school is a K-5 school. So with two, and they're on different shifts also. The issue comes when you're dealing with the extended day and the after day, when the seventh and eighth graders who are involved in sports or extracurricular activities have to get to a high school. The supervision of them, because they're on an early line school, they're being supervised at the school and not coming here to the main campus. So it becomes an issue of keeping an eye on those secondary students once they're done. Because once they're done, the K-5 students are still in school. That's why we think they can move down one and supplement that with a half time. Heritage and South, I believe, have six.
Mr. Levinstein, is your microphone on?
Yes.
Okay. Everybody wants to hear what we all have to say.
No, the main problem at the middle schools and the main campus and the north campus is the issue of the metal detectors and getting students in on time. So the morning is a crunch and the afternoons are the crunch. And the in-between part is, you know, basically monitoring the hallways, and you know, they are large buildings. Anything can happen, but you know, they're gonna have to find other ways, whether there's additional alternatives.
Other questions or comments on this recommendation? Mrs. McAfee, do you want to wait on the discussion about whether we want the security guards back in the elementary buildings for the next school year until you get this copy of the report that Mr. Casales, or do you want to have that discussion?
Yeah. I don't think I could be that part of the discussion until I see if you've got the information.
Okay.
Next two items deal with retirement incentive expenses for the employee's retirement system, the teacher retirement system. Based on the current list of retirees, the expense for the employee's retirement system can be reduced by $14,000. However, because there's no timeline as to when CSEA can submit a retirement letter, this may have to be adjusted at a later date. As for the teacher retirement system, we're currently in the final year of the 2010-11 incentive that was offered to the NTA. And that this year, the final year, is the cheapest of the three payouts. The administrative bargaining unit is only in their third year of the incentive offer that in 2010-11. So along with those items and the current list of retirees, this budget line for the retirement expense can be reduced by $200,000.
Any questions or comments on that?
Questions?
Yes, Mr. Levinstein.
So the teacher that's on here, that position is vacant, and we recommend you not filling it, but the services that that teacher did or could have provided is being taken away.
Yes.
Other questions or comments? Consensus on the elimination of these two retiring positions not being backfilled for the 2013-2014 school year with a reduction to the budget in the amount of $189,833. Ms. Brokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Yes.
Schedule B, recommend that two clerical positions, one down in the curriculum instruction department, and one in district clerk's office, be eliminated. Also recommended for reduction is the executive director of technology position. The duties and responsibilities will be distributed as follows. The business office will assume the district technicians with oversight of the district systems infrastructure. CNI will assume responsibilities for education technology, chief information officer, programmers, data collection, and school library services with the assistance of the assistant superintendent for human resources and the Newburgh Free Library Director. The coordinator of family and community involvement will assume attendance and registration functions. Net savings of those three positions is $326,034.
Comments? Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
Question.
Yes.
And you're assuming that those duties can be assumed by those three parts of our structure without the addition of anyone there to handle. In other words, I'm concerned as to who's going to do the duties.
Well, currently there's two main level managers under the technology department. One that deals with the systems infrastructure, and one is the chief information officer. That will be basically the director that will report to the business office, similar to the way the transportation director would in the food service, and same thing with CNI. That person would report to the curriculum instruction team between Dr. Shanahan, Ms. Forget, and Ms. Angela Lundy. With regards to the community, family, and community involvement coordinator, she's currently housed there, and she holds a certification, and is certainly certified and qualified to handle the attendance and registration as a function of her apparent liaison duties.
Yeah, I'm just concerned about time.
It's going to be a time crunch, but we understand that there's a budget crunch.
Right.
So we all have to be as
prepared. So they will be able to find the time because it's going to be said by someone in the community that it raises the issue of whether we needed the executive director of technology in the first place.
Well, we need all the positions, but when you have to do without, to get to $9.8 million, we find creative ways to get there.
Right. You need to be a bit more creative. Yes, we move
forward. Your question is valid, obviously, and we feel as though, this was not a haphazard decision that we made. We broke down the different jobs, and we added slices to different people, as Mike has just outlined. We feel it'll work with that model. And we feel as though, again, as Mike has said, in these hard times, we have to make decisions that are hard as well. No one wants to do this, but we feel as though we have to in order to get down to our number. But we think it'll work. We think it's valid. It's not a desperation move that maybe it'll work and maybe it won't. We very strongly feel that way it will work.
And I think that's the reassurance that I need about, because when we talk about 21st century education, obviously instructional technology is right up there at the top.
Definitely.
Yeah. So we don't want to have to get lost amongst other duties.
But we feel with this model we can cover the administrative part of the technology plus the instructional part, the classroom piece. And we feel strongly that it will work.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Forte, would you like to add anything?
Do you want more clarification as well?
No, I don't think so.
Any other questions or comments in the reductions to the central office? Yes, Mr. Woodhull. Put your microphone on, Mr.
Excuse me. I'm just not sure that dropping the executive director of technology at this time is really a good idea, because we're really just starting to bring back iPads and things like this for some of our students, and we need people to understand what's going on, and we're bringing in, you know, cameras, automatic door openers and things like this through security, and to take and not get somebody that's really familiar with technology, I think this might be a mistake.
Mr. Woodall, I can only reiterate what I just said to Judy McAfee, that we feel as though the model that we put together will work. We feel very strongly that it will work. We're not saying anything about the people that were there before. We're saying that in these hard times and trying to get to the number of 9.5 million, that these are some of the things that we looked at long and hard, and we've come up with a different model. But we feel very strongly that it will work. I can't reiterate that enough. But thank you for your input.
Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Lewis.
Will there be another forum where we can discuss some of these personnel things? Because there's some items that I think we could include some changes at a different level, but there are some personnel issues here that I don't think should be discussed.
Well, these are the things that you will decide when you want to go into executive session. If we're going to be talking about people in positions, that we can do that. But we will have to come back and get hold in public. Okay.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, then we'll bubble this item as well, as there will be further discussion in executive session for.
Schedule C deals with district-wide vacant cleaning positions. The district has operated the current year with 6 cleaning positions that have not been filled. During the budget rollover process, these positions were carried into the draft budget. On the evaluation of Mr. Velez, it's recommended not to fill them going forward, causing a reduction in the draft budget. This reduction is $355,107 for the 6 positions.
Questions, comments? Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
Just a concern. When I think back to these last couple of years, it seems like the buildings and grounds has taken some other cuts. I'm wondering if the buildings are still being, you know, duly maintained.
As far as I know, I need to check with Mr. Blaise and the building principals.
Mr. Velez is here. Would you like to hear from him? Mr. Velez, I can't see you, but I know you're out there somewhere.
You want to step up to the microphone, Mr. Velez?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Last year, we carried over those positions when we went to the Wednesday to Sunday shift.
Yes.
And we carried them over just in case we have a problem. We haven't used them, and we are keeping the building on the same standard that we had before that. So I met with Mike, I just talked to the head custodians and some of the principals, and we can eliminate those positions.
So, are these positions that at one time, say last year or the year before, we did have filled?
Yes. And we haven't filled them for this whole year.
Because remember, we had the change, we had the negotiated change with the CSEA with the different schedules.
So the rotated schedule has really worked?
It has worked, yes.
Yes. And that's part of the reason why we can make this change. As long as the buildings are maintained, Andy, I'm fine with it.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Bliss.
That right there, those three words, and they are clean. That's the assurance that we all need.
Other questions, comments?
Madam President, there's one more piece. I want to apologize. We are planning on shifting the extra earnings between the grounds extra earnings. We're reducing that by $50,000 and placing it into the buildings and sub account by $50,000. But we're experiencing again attendance problems. So in order to supplement that, we're going to recommend a shift in the budget lines. No effect on the bottom line.
Okay.
So instead of addressing the extra earnings, that money would be covered to cover the subs.
The subs, right.
But it maintains the full company.
Yes.
Yes.
Other questions or comments on this item? And I will take consensus on the reduction of the buildings and grounds line in the amount of $355,107. Mr. Woodhull?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levenstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Yes.
Schedule D, C&I recommended line item budgets. It's recommended that all the building, instructional furniture, and equipment get reduced in half. And the GOSA's in-service budget line be reduced fully. The total is $80,000 less.
Yes, Mrs. McAfee.
Could you give an example of what was being included in equipment?
It's furniture.
Right, but the furniture doesn't bother me nearly as much as the equipment. Would that be on our smart boards?
No, not necessarily. If it's a district-wide initiative, then the smart boards would go through the technology department, and then the district has an equipment line that would want something like that. That's separate from each school. Small items throughout the year.
This would not be instructional.
No. Well, it could be instructional equipment,
yeah,
but it's not.
The smart board would be instructional equipment.
A lot of the smart boards that we buy now in McAfee are grant funded. But anything with that type of initiative, like I said, the district has an equipment line to handle district-wide initiatives if it's deemed appropriate by the superintendent and the senior IT. So we have enough funds to cover any smart boards that may want to be put in next year.
Or an iPad for a grade level or something like that. What this is, Mrs. McAfee, if I understand correctly, Mr. Pacella, is if a building principal has a line item for instructional furniture and equipment and wanted to buy just for their building an extra smart board or an extra copier or something like that, that's what this would affect. So it's reducing their ability to buy something specifically just for their building by half.
And you would still decide what the money was used for?
Through conversations with the principals, yes.
It's one of the things we train kids, you know, students for at the college, and they come back and say, we've never seen an owl in school, so.
Other questions or comments on this item? Okay. Then I will take consensus on the reduction of the line item recommendations for a total savings in the budget of $80,000. Ms. Rush?
Yes.
Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
Yes.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Whipple?
Yes.
Yes.
Schedule E, the elementary and middle school staffing recommendations, reductions. The attached calculations are provided and with rationale provided by Mr. Forget. And as I mentioned earlier, there were many meetings with building administrator and senior staff to come to these recommended reductions. You'll notice that there's a net FTE reduction recommended of 23.4 positions, totaling just over $2 million.
Questions? Yes, Mrs. Pat.
Why are we closing one of the two libraries at Town Hall, but not in both? So that would be an effort. And we worked so hard at Advance, as I understand, to create a single library with the two portions, parts of it, so that we're going to have an elementary part of it and an upper grade, you know, 6, 7, 8 section. So wouldn't this be an effort that we worked so hard to work?
One of the things that we did, Mrs. McAfee, was we sat down with all the elementary principals and we did talk about the equity and the consistency of programs across the K-8 levels. And each of the buildings utilizes the staff differently to cover specials, to allow for common planning time, different types of requirements that they have built into their master schedules. So, you will see some differences in recommendations from each of the schools, but what we agreed to as a K-18 was that the services that will be provided to a student will be maintained to the greatest extent possible, whether it be through combining library and media resources in one particular school, whether it be creating a duty period for some people to share in the responsibilities. But we looked at trying to maintain a program for each of the various different types of positions that you saw here across our K-8 level. We explored class sizes, we explored enrollment, we looked at regulation requirements. None of us wants to cut anything at this point because our students are in demand of these particular services and they deserve them. But at this point, you know, we as a team have to look at it and see where could we do kind of the least harm at this particular point.
I'm sorry, Mr. Forget, Meadow Hill, do they have one librarian covering both libraries?
No, they have two. So they have a different master scheduler and a different rotation of people that cover for different things than the other schools.
And for GAMS, was the thought to just have one librarian covering both of those libraries? Or did that not get discussed?
That has been discussed, but the decision has not been made. There is the consideration of going to the library and being special education.
Mrs. McAfee.
My concern, Eric, goes back perhaps before your time in the district, to when I first got involved in the library. And we actually had a situation at point in some of our elementaries where not all children are going to the library. Most were, some are not. Some who went were not able to check out books. And we worked very hard to bring everyone then into the library and make sure that they had that same practice experience, because that's what the library books really provide. And if you can assure me that that's still going to happen in Tuckerville, then I would assume that I would be fine. But that would be my question. You know, that no child is going to be excluded from the library, and that all will, in fact, like once a rotation, be able to get a book and that they can practice what they're really about. This is just... Yeah, we know, but I'm repeating, just so we hear that we said it.
Well, go ahead. Go ahead. I was going to say something about the library. Is it still on the librarian?
Yes.
Okay, all right, so go ahead, and then I'll ask a question. Go ahead, Ms. Howard.
I have an even greater concern for the elimination of what I believe is the library at South Middle School. So now we're not going to have a library at South Middle School?
In conversations with the staff, it's been determined that that library will be covered, whether it be with other, like the technology teacher or other teachers participating through duties to allow access to the library for those particular students at this point.
Again, way before your time, we actually eliminated all of our elementary libraries and staffed them with parents and with student teachers. And when the day came that we reopened our libraries as really functioning structures and brought our librarians back, those libraries were decimated. They had not been handled appropriately. The people who were there might have been well-intentioned and they put in their time, but they didn't necessarily have the skills of the librarians. So, as the chair of the library committee, I'm very concerned about this because it's what we've been working to put together for a number of years. And it would have been great to have been able to have some input. I know I'm getting the chance to do that now. But I'm very concerned that one of our middle schools, we're preparing kids for college level research, is not going to have a library. And I find it difficult to believe that we can provide equal service with different teachers. Our technology.
Right, so speaking to the equity across the buildings, and I don't know because I wasn't part of the discussion about the scheduling of Meadow versus Temple, but if you feel that Temple can run with one library and a library media specialist for both libraries, then to me it would make more sense to keep the librarian at South Middle School and go to one librarian at Meadow Hill. So instead of leaving two and having a middle school with no librarian, I'd rather see the librarian from Meadow, wherever it works out, go to South to keep it there, and then they all have one librarian.
And I certainly don't know what the reasoning was behind the decision not to do it that way, but as a layperson, that would make sense.
Well, I think you mentioned, Mr. Forget, that it was based on the schedule, but again, in the sense of equity across the buildings, what about changing that schedule to provide more equity?
Well, it sounds like this is one of the high priorities for the board, and obviously it's a priority for us as well. If you'd like us to go back and revisit the library positions in each of the schools, I'd be more than happy to do that with the principals and with the teams that we work with.
I'd certainly like to follow up on Dawn's suggestion, because I think it has some of it. And we just had a curriculum meeting on Tuesday, talked about the fact that we're working with the local colleges on college readiness. And it just seems to me
like close reading
at South Middle School might have just taken a step backwards.
We'll research further and speak to each of those particular programs, analyze the master schedule, and come back to it.
Other questions on IEP? Yes, Ms. Prokosh.
Yeah, I have a question on the foreign language teachers. I noticed here a carrot teacher talking about 2.4 reduction, and at the South School, into, because the population's not going down. And you cannot have that many kids students in a foreign language class and be able to cover what you need to cover. I mean, I know that there was one class that in heritage that had 44. They had a great teacher over from Temple Hill School to help out. So that definitely has to be looked into. And I would not give it to see what the population of the classes are. And you can't do 35 in foreign language. When you're given final exams, you have to do the world final exams to start in February. We have to look at something, and I know we're in the budget crunch, and I understand that, but we have to look at something more than just numbers. And I know that it says in law that you can put 35 in a class, but you cannot give a teacher 5 classes of 35 because that's over what is supposed to be allowed. So the 35 to me is a number that shouldn't even be approached. In our education system right now, we're trying to get high school graduation requirements done and have more students graduate from high school. To me, the maximum in any class should be 30, and that's pushing it. You know, it's just that we're doing a disservice to our students. And I know, again, we're in a crunch, I understand that, but we have to look for other ways other than reducing the people that are front lines teaching these kids. So I hope we have this look into further. Please.
Ms. Rush?
I know it says reduction, not elimination, at the art and the music. I'm a little concerned, but I don't want to, you still have enough that all the kids are going to do, but at least what about the math specialist? That's kind of...
That was a change in the way that we deliver the elementary services in the school. In consultation with the administration, they felt that they couldn't make the elementary services students within the way that they're doing the delivery of the AIS services. And I was assured that that would be
Mr. Lewis?
What is the job description of an AIS teacher?
An academic intervention services teacher is a teacher that provides either direct or indirect support to students who, based on the district criteria, are not performing based on their state assessments. So those students that are in grades 3 through 8 that perform at levels 1 and 2 on New York State assessment were mandated to provide some type of an intervention to give those students the supports they need in the general education classrooms. So it could be a push-in and a team teaching environment, and then one teacher takes a smaller group of students and does individual instruction. It could be they get pulled out for an extended period of time to work on a specific skill. It could be the entire grade level works on what they're calling intervention periods, and the entire grade level breaks the kids and groups them for instruction and provides support so that the students are successful in the mainstream classroom.
So we could afford to get rid of two of them?
I'm sorry?
We could afford to get rid of two of those teachers?
Honestly, Mr. Lewis, we can't afford to get rid of any of them.
I mean, but there's so many kids in early childhood education seems to me to use these two teachers in a different school. With these African American kids that are suffering from day one. I mean, they need all kind of help. We're almost 48% of our kids not going to do it. African American kids. And it seems to me that these are the kids that start the school so far behind. And maybe those two people there can go to a different school where kids are really suffering. I know we have to cut, but I just give my feeling about what's happening here. Because as we go further, I have to battle about these African American kids that are not making it out of the district, and I don't know why.
next year?
The last item.
Is that the instrumental that we spent so much time talking about?
It wasn't. It is instrumental. However, we'll maintain the instrumental. We shifted and scheduled it a little bit differently. We're capitalizing on the entry time of students and the departure time of students. Ms. Brown did an extensive analysis of the K-5 program to maintain the opportunity for our students to still receive those instrumental lessons, but also the ability to reduce our positions by shifting things and sharing positions between schools. So the program will be maintained, but it will take a little bit of finessing and coordinating with principal to principal and schedules.
So that all meant that the kids will get the same thing next year that they have been getting this year?
That is our plan.
So the instrumental will continue starting at the fourth grade level.
Could I ask that we, if we're going to vote for consensus, that we remove the two librarians, the AIS teacher and the foreign language teacher, before we make consensus?
There's I have them circled. Are we looking at the foreign language teachers at Heritage, or the foreign language teachers at Heritage and South?
Both. So because then Mr. Vassell will remove them and give me a new total of savings before I take consensus. Further questions or comments on this? Okay, so while he's working up the number, what I'll take consensus on is reductions at the elementary/middle school level, which will not include the librarian Temple Hill. It will not include librarian at South Middle School. It will not include the two AIS teachers at Meadow Hill School. And it will not include the foreign language teacher at Heritage Middle School. And it will not include the foreign language teacher at South Middle School.
The recommended reduction was $2,015,000. With those positions out, the new reduction is $1,327,000.
Consensus is on the reduction of at the elementary/middle school level, a total of 15.5 FTEs for a total savings to the budget of $1,327,300. Mr. Lewis?
Yes.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yes.
Mr. Levinstein?
No.
Ms. Prokosh?
Yes.
Mr. Woodhull?
No.
Ms. Rush?
Yes.
Yes.
Item F is a schedule of the NFA recommended curriculum reductions. We have the attached calculations and then a memo from the active co-principals. So Mr. Ford outlining each one of these recommendations.
Are we talking about only the reduction of teachers?
Mr. Forge, do you think this will, the discussion of the teachers for the recommended reductions here will have to be considered with the other recommendation? Because if so, then we'll pull them both out and...
Well, he's checked with his papers. I would say yes, John, because otherwise it doesn't make any sense. You can't really discuss the reductions unless you have a reason for possibly looking at reductions. And right now, that hasn't been reported.
I can share with you the parameters by which this work was done. Dr. Shanahan worked with very closely with the directors and with some representation from the administration. Each of the schedules were reviewed at the current main campus and North Campus for enrollment in courses and trends of electives and how many kids were participating in different courses. We found some low enrollments, and we found some classes that, based on the Aspen Academies, we would have been able to schedule those students for an English class or a math class if they were in a different house. And in doing that and conducting that analysis, the consideration was, would it be more cost effective for us to consider remaining with the themes? So making sure that the students still had access to the different programs that we offer, but allowing them to participate in core classes outside of their current house. And in doing so, the analysis of the schedule was done, and that's where these particular recommendations are generated. We also went to, and again, we were doing it based on contractual requirements. We looked at increasing class size. And as a result of increasing class size, basically to the max, for the core classes for average learners, not including AIS students or special education students, this was the final recommendation at that point. Is there anything else that...
Essentially, that was the process. Looking at the where we found class sizes that were low, as Mr. Forge said, due, as was explained to us, mostly because of the house structure, because the students were scheduled in their house for these courses. It caused a number of courses to be relatively small. So when we were looking for reductions, the implication of that was the house structure would, to some degree, be affected. By maintaining the electives, the administration of the high school will maintain the themes of the house, but not the house as it is known now, where most of the courses are taken in one house.
Mr. McAvoy.
Can you clarify that? What are you saying is going to happen to the houses and cabinets at Newburgh?
Students will be assigned to their core classes anywhere in the building, not just in the house. If they are interested in the courses that are related to the house, arts, for example, they can still take those electives. Those are still going to exist. But the structure of a house, when we're considering increasing class size, it's impossible to schedule. So if you have the houses that have the themes associated with them and the electives that represent those themes, those are still going to exist. Geographical change, but the result is that you won't have that more intimate, smaller community with a limited space that the student is taking most of the classes in, which was the idea of the house.
And would they then lose the identity of being in a cabin or house? In other words, the guidance counselor, the administrator, you know, would
be affected, yes.
It almost sounds like it would end. And that's what I'm trying to get clarification on. Because to me, you can't talk about the teacher reductions that you're requesting unless you're forthright about saying, you know, what it is you are proposing that we do at Newburgh Free Academy, which was a tremendous surprise to me. You guys really kept a secret. I didn't know anything about it. I'm not sure where anybody did. So, Ed, you nodded when I said so, that it was really a wrap. The guidance counselor, the administrator.
Yes, this is actually there. We have to be a totally new structure for that, and the identity would have to change. We were provided with a task. The task was to take a look at the schedules, to consider what could be done within the schedules to create consistency across class sizes. If we're given that charge and we're asked to do that, then this is going to be something we're going to have to consider. What would Newburgh Free Academy look like? What we tried to do is to remain with the themes so that the students could still participate in those particular electives and in those courses and still be able to graduate with that particular theme and be prepared to go to a college that aligns with that. But based on what we're requested to do, we couldn't maintain the houses the way they're structured right now. When you talk about the assistant principals being assigned to it, no, they would probably be assigned based on a cohort. So they would enter with the ninth grade students and follow those students all the way through. It would be a very different model. But again, we were asked to see where we could reduce the budget. No one's saying whether we are happy about this or not. This is a really difficult thing. I mean, this has been a part of the high school for many years. So
I agree with that, but I think my concern is that, you know, in order for us to vote, it seems to me like we have to understand, you know, what it is that would happen.
What the new organization.
If we don't understand it, then right. You know, we're not fulfilling our responsibility. We're just really doing, you know, perhaps saying, we'll get rid of these teachers. Go on.
I think one thing that's been left out so far from what I'm hearing is that we were up against a number of classes that were under-enrolled the last few years. And that was one of the things that we had to talk about, and one of the things that had to be addressed. I mean, some of the numbers were single digits.
Yeah. And I do know that, though. And in fact, I had recently spoken to Ed and perhaps even to Daniel also about the fact of could go and take a look at the enrollment of some of the elective courses, because I was concerned about that, but I never thought it was going to bounce back on what was spent. We spent years putting together the academy and house structure, under Dr. Saturnelli and with community input as well as teachers and administrators, and it just seems to me like over a two-day period, you can't take.
Ms. Prokosh, you were next.
Yes, I just want to reiterate a little bit. There was a reason for Newburgh Free Academy going to a house academy plan. There was a reason for it. It was to give the students a more sense of a smaller center. To me, it's been extremely successful. To go back the way it was, and to getting rid of teachers again on 35 in a class, which is what this scenario is. All right, is a disservice to the students. I can see more innovative scheduling. If you like, if there's classes, let's say in the arts academy that are small, then condense them down to less core classes so that the class numbers rise. And maybe a teacher that instead of teaching totally in that academy would teach in another house for a period or so. And you could reduce some numbers, but not to devastate the house plan and the academies, because that's the identity. And that makes a lot of middle school children looking forward to come here. And they're very strong houses. Some houses maybe not as strong. There's very strong houses at NFA North. I can't see doing it. I can see, and I had talked to Mr. Forget earlier about maybe doing something with a flex schedule with teachers also. That, you know, we run the Twilight program at in the evening, which is a costly thing. And we used to have split schedules here at NFA in years past. Maybe teachers would, some teachers would come in later and teach later, and then they'll teach in the Twilight. So that fact is taken out as far as the, and also be able to do some AIS and maybe reduce numbers down to, let's say, four or three reductions rather than six and five and so forth. You know, we have to think a little bit out of the box, but still keep the integrity, I think, of the houses, because that gives, I mean, a lot of students, that's what makes them come here. We're always saying that, you know, there's absentee problems and so forth, but a lot of students come here because they're in an academy and because they're in a particular house, and I don't want to see that. I taught in the Newburgh system when we didn't have it and it was awful, and I don't want to see us go back that way. And if we also can't go on again, the number of 35 in class, we can't. And expect graduation is great to get better with 35 class. And I know, I guess, we're guessing, we have to think of five other ways, especially with the course.
Mr. Woodhull.
Yes, I'm concerned about the students that entered ninth grade up at NFA, up at the North Campus, and are taking, say, criminal justice or something like courses like this, and now we're taking and telling them, well, your course might not be offered here anymore, but it's going to get offered down at, you know, the main campus, or it may not get offered at all. And we brought these children together to study under a particular subject that they wanted to master in. And I think we're doing a great disservice to get rid of these houses. These children enjoy it. And I know several that were actually planning on finishing up at ninth, their 10th year this year, up at NFA, up at Newburgh, and then coming down here this year to take another set of subjects, say law or something like that. And we can't take and just keep pulling these kids around. It's not fair to them.
Mr. Forget, can you speak to that, please?
Yeah, I don't think there was any intention of taking those programs down. That was not our intention. Those students will still have the access to those programs if they weren't campus.
But what about the student that wants to take and is finished that section of their courses at the North Campus and now wants to move down to the main campus here and take another set, say legal, you know, the legal end of it, and we find out that, oh, we're only going to have a couple, and there's no room for it. I think we've done these children a disservice.
There were many ideas considered for solutions to problems just like that, and one of them being creating distance learning courses that could connect the two campuses. So if there were students, or a small number of students at the North Campus who are at the last stage of a series of courses, the enrollment would be really low. At Maine, there's a similar course. Finding a way to schedule those two courses at the same time and just broadcast one over to the other one is one idea that we had to maintain the integrity as much as possible in both campuses, especially for North, because we still want students to be drawn to that campus.
Mr. Lewis.
Hey, will this affect the administrative structure at least?
The way it will affect the administrative structure is instead of They'll track by cohort. The assistant principals will follow by cohort. So the entering ninth grade, an AP would be assigned by the executive principal and oversight by the vice principal. But they'll track those kids from grade to grade. So that's the change in the structure. The numbers will not change.
So the numbers of the assistant principal will still stay as is?
Yes, that's the recommendation.
Graduation rate of our minority students somewhere in the vicinity of 40, 45, 50%. It's getting to 50, probably, sure. And I think all we're doing is having a feeder system for Tom Fitzgerald's program, for the charter school, because we're going to have more and more kids drop out. If you get rid of this structure that it took us not 2 or 3 years, 4 or 5 or 10, when Dr. Wilson was in this service. And I just can't see us tearing that whole system apart and going back to where we were. That's how we got on that service. And that's how we got off of it, because we came up with some new ideas. But then now we're going back. I don't know. I think it's totally wrong. I think we need to try to save that program and try to look at some other ways of
cutting.
What I want to say here would just be really a summary of other comments. Everything about the academies and the houses to me was that smaller room.
Yes.
And because of it, it brought a smaller group, let's say, of kids and teachers together with the guidance counselor and administrator, and you had a team approach. Kids felt important. They felt like people knew them, and that was part of it. I think another section, though, is that the kids had choice. If we want our kids to come to school and stay in school, they got to feel like they want to be there. That there are courses that are really important to them. And I'm just afraid with the change that some of those courses can start to be lost. I know you're trying to reassure us that that's not going to happen, but as soon as the integrity of the House of Academy is lost, then it would be pretty easy to start lopping off some of those electives. And finally, even if we maintain the rigor in college prep courses, I would be concerned for those career prep. I think that's what Tom was referring to. Now, because those are the kids who often don't think that school is worthwhile, and the kids that we need to be most concerned about reaching. And that is such a heart and soul part of this system that we had developed. I just think we need to take a step back from it. We started our budget process early, and we acknowledge that. So maybe we've got a little time that we can take a look at it before we start dismantling quickly. Something that Cox says 10 years, I wasn't sure how long it had been, but that sounds about right. But this is too quick. And I think then you have lots of time to restart.
So let me, obviously this is going to need further discussion, but let me ask this of any of the board members, because as you know, and as the administration knows, if you take this off the table for all of the, particular reasons that were mentioned here and very valid reasons that were mentioned here, then we are still charged as a group with now finding $1.8 million somewhere else. So I would just like to know if anybody, again, this is going to be a continuing discussion, but anybody at this time has any other suggestions so that we wouldn't have to consider this, where we might look, because this is a big ticket item. So it's going to be hard. As with the reductions the last year's budget, we looked for $15 million. In the previous year, we looked for $19 million. And over those 2 years, we lost over 300 employees in the district. So we are down to nothing but program and staff. And so it's a very difficult charge for everyone sitting up here. So I'm just asking, you know, again, all very valid reasons that I truly believe, you know, that the administration took into consideration, the very difficult decisions that we all collectively have to make as a group. And so I'm just wondering if there's any other things that maybe weren't in our packet tonight that you might possibly think would address not having to look at this.
There may be, but some of the things I say we can't talk about.
In executive, okay. Yes, Mrs. McAleer.
I don't think that I think there are two conversations going on. To me, one of them is staff reduction that would be possible because of present low enrollment.
Mm-hmm.
Some of that may be very just, and if you show us those figures, I think that we would be willing to look at that very
seriously. To do that, but without looking at the piece of dismantling the academy's house structure.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So keep it as two separate things, at least for right now. And you know, let the discussion show us the validity of your argument.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Ms. Crowe.
That's why I think we need to table this until the things that we've discussed tonight can be investigated.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, along with what we talked about, the flex and incorporating other things and keeping things intact as far as that, the academy or houses. So I think if we table tonight, we can then investigate further. And there probably will be some reductions, but not these.
Right, that would specifically,
some type of other thinking.
Okay. Other questions, comments? Okay. So we'll look at this item.
Schedule G, H, and I are taken together. They deal with the three elementary schools that were mentioned at the last meeting. You requested some additional information. You requested the scoreboards. You have five scoreboards, the enrollments, which will show your current enrollment, then next year enrollment as though all schools are open, and then the enrollment or the scoreboard showing if one school is closed and the other school is closed, and what that does to school capacity, the seat capacity. So, the recommended school to be closed is Horizons. If this school is chosen, being that it's located in the city of Newburgh, we'd be able to do the following. Central office will move to Horizons, allowing for the Newburgh Free Library to grow. Registration will move from Washington Street to Horizons. Special ed offices would move from Chestnut to Horizons. The Welcome Center would move from Washington Street to the Newburgh Free Library Complex. And technology would move from Washington to Chestnut. With all of that, Washington Street would be vacant for possible sale or lease to local businesses that offered early education. We've also provided you other information with regards to the last 3 years' worth of parental choices for kindergarten schools. And they go from first to last over the last 3 years, so I'm not going to read through them. You asked for the costs that we spent to date. They're included in here. To upgrade those three buildings to Horizons, we spent $4.45 million. We'll need to spend another $1.6 million to upgrade it for the remainder. At Bonneville, we spent $7.8 million, and we would need to spend another $1.1 million to upgrade it. And at Bales Gate, we spent $2.875 million with an $879,000 estimate to upgrade.
Could I ask for a clarification on the real estate expense? The $879,000 upgrade, aren't we anticipating that very shortly we might have to replace those modules?
Mr. Velez, can you speak to the facility at Bales Gate? Yes.
The $879,000 to upgrade addition of Valescape, I'm assuming that couldn't possibly include the modulars.
No, that's not the way to build it.
And aren't we concerned that those modulars, which were supposed to be gone years and years ago, are not going to last much longer?
I'm concerned about that. We've said that several times.
Yeah, and so isn't this figure unrealistically low?
The main way we look at it, when we did the 5-year capital plan, we didn't talk about the modulars, the modulars because of the class size in the building. We have a choice if we want to demolish, I have a cost if we want to remove them. But then we have to reprogram the building to move those classrooms into the main part of the building. I have a cost for that. If you need it, I can provide you that.
So you mean we don't need the modulars anymore?
If you go by the enrollment, if you reprogram the building, probably not, but that's a discussion that we have to have with the school administration.
Well, I'm really questioning that money figure. Yeah,
that money figure, the only $800,000 from an electrical upgrade to the building does not include the modulars. If you want to know how much it costs, I have that in my office, I can provide that.
So how much it would cost to either upgrade the modulars or to replace them?
You have to replace them, you cannot upgrade them. Okay. They were built in 1964.
Then I think we need that figure.
I can give you that.
Mr. Lewis.
Okay, is there a cost to upgrade Horizon into the Board of Ed building?
We haven't looked at any cost to retrofit any move that we make until it's decided that that's the case, because there's a lot of ramifications to whatever school you decide. If it's not Horizon, because I didn't cost out the move of Washington Street, we didn't explore with the company that was interested in Washington Street last year what the rent could possibly be, and then certainly didn't discuss with the Newburgh Free Library regarding the retrofitting of the fourth floor and absorbing the Welcome Center. There's a lot that fall out just due to time and effort, really. I didn't think it was necessary at this point.
Okay. We're talking about leaving one elementary school in the city, is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, that's it. So you would survive about 4, 3, and 1. And the town of Newburgh has 3 and 1. The same way that all we've been doing is busing kids out of the city to the suburbs. And that is right at all.
Have more. I mean, that's not equitable. I really think that we have Miss Eve. So for Verizon's, I really think, you know, it needs to stay stabilization of the city. And I also have that question about the smack being on the modulars. And, you know, if one of the three had to go, I mean, I don't see any go, but one of the three, to me, would be the one with the modulars. And, if you move the board of ed to the right, you need to be able to stay too. As far as if you want to move out of the town of London. I just hate to see if we lose another school in the city.
Mr. Pacella?
Yeah, the issue is not that the central office wants to move out of the library. We're doing this to try to create another building open for a lease or for sale to generate additional revenue. The Board of Ed moving out of the city didn't come into play. Verizon was chosen because it affects the least amount of children, and it's centrally location, it's centrally located within the city to house the functions of the district, as well as some of the other functions that the attendance administration, which is still walkable to many people in the city. That was the purpose, not for any other reason about the Board of Ed.
If you closed Hill's Gate, you couldn't sell that or rent that?
Well, it'd be a little more difficult because the organization
would,
huh?
Location's better.
Not for the organizations that are looking for schools. These organizations look for schools are looking for inner city property.
Well, then you can still move out of Washington Street to the technology and whatever out of Washington Street to the
LSK. Yeah.
You still have Washington Street.
Well, there's a lot more than just technology. But if you can't move the attendance registration, you could do it. But then you take away the fact that people can't walk there to do what they need to do to register. We can do whatever you're...
You were saying they can walk to the library conference.
A lot of people do, yes.
So the Board of Education will be moved out of the library conference?
Board of Ed, well, we didn't discuss moving that.
Well, that's what you said.
At Horizons.
To Horizons.
Correct.
But you couldn't move them, you couldn't move the Board of Ed to the LSK.
We can move wherever he tells him, but it just may
be... No, I'm just asking.
Yeah, we can.
Okay, but then it would be a moot point when it comes to the registration, because you have them, you said, in the board rules, right? Where the board is now. So that's a moot point of that. So the registration is...
Well, we said it would
move
to the registration. That's what you said in here.
Registration was going to Horizons with the board office. The Welcome Center was going to go to the Newburgh Free Library.
But if you're going to have the same person do the registration and the Welcome Center, the same person, they should be in the same building.
Well, we haven't worked it out that far. We'll certainly can.
Ms. Rush?
So could we, if they have the lowest enrollment, we could possibly move those two into Horizons and protect Horizons? Because I'm just coming from a business standpoint. We invested more money into Horizons than Bales Gate. The difference is $600,000, which means there's really only $120,000 difference into what would be needed for Horizons. Right? We're coming from a business point of view. So if we still had Bales Gate to lease out, it may not be the same people, but then there is an opportunity, as you said, to restructure the other two.
This rush is $600,000 for the upgrade?
Well, there's a difference of 123. I'm going by the 1.6, right? To upgrade or
yeah,
the difference right. Between what it would cost us to close one to the other, $600,000, which is right?
You're looking at the upgrade cost.
Right. But I'm also saying that the difference between Bales Gate and Horizons is $600,000.
For the upgrade. The upgrade.
No, the closing the school, isn't it?
Oh, you're looking at the total cost of the
year. Yeah, I'm looking at it side by side.
I didn't know where you were comparing to.
I have a weird way of looking at business. It's quite, it works for me, though.
Right, so repeat that once more.
You correct me if I'm wrong, because I...
No, you're correct.
Okay. So well, what else?
Let me just give the numbers. The cost to close Horizons, or the reduction would be $4.5 million. And cost to close Bonneville will be $4.4 million, and the cost to close Vale Gate would be $5.2 million.
Right, so the differential between Horizons and Vale Gate, right, is about $600,000. So what I'm saying is, in the bigger picture, if we keep an inner city school, the money, we're not talking about that big a difference. And yes, I'm sure Horizons would be easier to lease, but I don't think we couldn't lease or maybe sell Bailsgate.
No.
The Bailsgate, they're not, the modulars are still what they are. I mean, they are, for years we've been saying, what are we going to do with those? I don't disagree.
Ms. Brokaw,
I have another question that I don't understand. You're talking about upgrades. You so much spent and then the upgrade. So we're still going to be spending $1.1 million to upgrade Bonneville in the future and $1.6 to upgrade. I mean, we're going to spend this money to upgrade.
This is based on, or I think I'm wrong, the building condition survey that has to be done every 5 years. Is that Mr. Velez? The cost to upgrade, $1.6 million to upgrade HOH, $1.1 to upgrade Bonneville, and $879,000 to upgrade Vale Gate, is that based upon the building condition survey that has to be done every 5 years?
Yes.
Yes.
And we have that, Mr. McGlade, with almost every building in the district, correct?
I have a cost for this building. So when the building up to the depot, you have to upgrade them every few years.
Right. So I mean, this is something that's an ongoing with every building.
Yes.
Yes.
And the report we got from the most recent building condition survey, it's a total of $30 million district-wide.
So this is not something that we would be doing this coming year.
No.
So that's almost the point as far as keeping them open or closing. The upgrades. Because that's not something that, and that's almost misleading to me. It's not going to be if we keep Horizons open, we're going to have $1.6 million in next year. That's not the case. That's, you know, our wish list or the things that we have to do eventually.
Things that we have to look at.
Look at, right.
Yes.
Right. And every school we have to look at things.
Well, we have the building condition survey. We surveyed all the schools. And they will have to get some upgrades every 5-10 years to bring them up to the new code.
Right.
This is what will be needed if we want to bring the building to the new code. If you do any work in any of these buildings, you have to bring them up to the code, and you will have to do that. If you leave them the way it is, the state won't make you do it, but they're recommending they will do it. Now, with the building condition survey in 5 years, if this stay there, this amount is going to increase. Eventually, it will have to be done.
But we don't have the money to put $1.6 million into anything.
We're not going to do any of this work now.
That should not be a consideration for keeping the school open for this coming year.
Right. It has to be addressed either through an energy performance contract or another capital project out to the voters at another time.
Correct. Right. So, the main recommendation would be to still be able to take, and much that I'm not going to
mention,
but over Horizons, just with the fact that after we keep in the school within the community. And then have a K-5 school within the district.
Mrs. McAfee?
Yeah, I would like to add another point to what I think would be an argument for keeping HOH in the school. And that is something we have spent, and I've been watching very carefully, we have spent quite a bit of money on conferences, training our IB teachers at HOH, and I think we finally have a faculty that is well versed in IB. We're proud of it, it's doing well, and now we would save $4,552,000 if we would take those teachers, and if they were to lose jobs, they would go somewhere. They'd go somewhere else in the district. And we would lose the advantage of all of those conferences that we've been sending them to. And some of those conferences were even this year. So to me, that's another point. We're not doing the long-range planning. I know the state is part of our problem, but we need to decide what we want to do. If we're going to have IB at HOH and we do all this training, then we need to keep it at a charge.
Okay, so I'm going to try to wrap this up a little bit and open it up for public discussion and suggestions. Based upon what I've heard, what the superintendent has heard, is it doesn't seem like the board would like Horizons to be a school for closure.
Right.
So if the consensus of the board that I would take would be for Vail's Gate, then is there also other information you would like to have? Like, it wouldn't be a consensus on closing Vail's Gate. It would be a consensus on you want to look at that as the building for closure. So, I'll do that, and then I'll ask the question about if we want what other information we'd be looking for, because we need to look at. I know we have the FTE positions and such. Maybe there's no other information we need, but let me just say that take consensus on changing from the closing of a building to go from Horizons to be Vail's Gate to be further investigated. So, Mrs. McAfee.
Yes.
Ms. Prokop.
Yes.
Mr. Lippel?
Yes.
Ms. Resch?
Yes.
Yes. Mr. Lewis? Did I skip you, Mr. Levenstein?
No, I mean, because I'm not Horizons, I don't want any of them.
Well, none of us do. I mean, that kind of goes without saying, but when you're down to nothing but program and staff, difficult decisions have to be made. So, that being said, I need to ask the board members, is there other information that is not currently in this packet that you would like to see regarding the closure of Vail's Gate?
As previously stated, the module is finished.
Okay. So Mr. Velez will be getting that for the board and giving it to Mr. Piso? Great.
It's just the cost to remove them or replace them. What other information besides
I have the same question.
Right. So if to replace them or fix them, but then what do you do with the kids? That has to be part of that equation too. In other words, if we do remove them, where do we move those children to?
Well, but if you close Vail's Gate, the students aren't going to be there.
Right. But if we keep it open, in other words, if I'm going to close, I have to have two choices.
Okay.
One choice has to be to close it, and the other one has to be to leave it open. So if I wanted to meet the board tomorrow on closing it, I would have to know that you've got a place to move those children. Right?
The children would be moved, no matter which one you close, to all of the other schools. They have to be absorbed in the rest of the buildings.
I thought that the first assumption was that those children from the modulars would go into Vail's Gate.
As far as I know, there are no children in the modulars.
And there's no modulars.
Well, I think they go in for maybe a period of day or something of that sort.
Yeah. So, I know you have the scorecards here, but can you just pull out quickly the total enrollment at Bond of Horizons and Vail's Gate, just so we know the numbers of students, because we have the numbers of staff and what the reduction would be in staff.
The current enrollment at Bonneville is, the building total is 562. At Vail's Gate, it's 577. And at Horizons, it's 536.
Okay, so really, and looking at that, it's only a difference of approximately 35 students that have to be disseminated throughout the district, Horizons versus Vail's Gate. Yes, Ms. Rush.
I actually thought that differential would be more, so it's really not that much, but if it is a classroom, then is there the potential, because you were talking about moving the registration over, so, you know what I mean? So I'd like to know if anything can be moved over there and you could leave, then maybe still sell Washington or East Washington. If there's enough that we can move the other two around so we still keep the inner city school, we still some of the others, and then we have two schools that we can lease and work out instead of one.
I think now that we know the board's wishes on that Vail's Gate is the chosen, then we'll go back and rework what we originally thought.
Okay, thanks.
Is Vail's Gate the chosen? Do you think it's
yes, we took consensus and it was unanimous. Wasn't to close it, no, but it was to look into and get the further information about the closing.
Yeah, I wanted to clarify that before we read the table and move tonight.
Somebody goes out and says, they said they're going to close Vail's Gate.
That's exactly what I want to say. That we're not, the vote that they took here, the consensus that was taken, was to look into and find more information about Vail's Gate. It was not to close Vail's Gate. So please don't leave here with the idea that we closed the school tonight. We did not. But that may happen in the coming weeks, but it hasn't happened yet.
Continued it for anyone over that age because they were trying to eliminate positions through attrition rather than layoffs. A much more humane and reasonable approach. I understand that the district had a retirement incentive a few years ago and had said at that time that another retirement incentive would not be offered, I think, until next year. But considering these very difficult times and the situation of our district and the state and the cuts that have to be made, I would suggest this is the time to reconsider that decision and to possibly consider another retirement incentive. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Clifton.
Grace Bowles. I just left the board of director meeting of the Newburgh Charter School, Newburgh Prep Charter School, and they said that they gave you information that for the next couple of years, you would be allowed to claim hardship and you would be able to get a couple million dollars as a result of you having to go to them. But they said that they don't know whether you responded to this or not.
I haven't received anything from them to that note. And according to the State Education Department, when we did the research, there's no hardship case and there's no additional aid because we don't meet the transitional thresholds. That's according to the State Education Department.
And if that information is available, if you could get back to them and ask them to please forward it because we have not seen it.
Okay, well, they said that they forwarded to you, but there was no response.
No, that Mrs. Bowles, nothing was forwarded from the charter school to us at all.
Okay.
No, I just want you to know that nothing was. Okay. I don't know who told you that, but it didn't happen.
Mr. Fitzgerald.
Didn't happen.
Thank you, Mrs. Bowles.
Hi. My name is Kelly Cassie. I'm the school psychologist at New Windsor School. I'm also the president of the New York Association of School Psychologists. I wanted to make you aware of a potential funding stream related to services provided by school psychologists. Back in 2007, the Center for Medicaid Services made a decision that school psychological services provided by school psychologists were no longer Medicaid reimbursable because school psychologists do not possess a license. NIASC is currently actively lobbying for licensure of school psychologists. We have legislation that has been introduced in the Senate and the Assembly, which would provide for licensure of school psychologists in New York State. Back in 2005, this district received approximately $120,000 for reimbursable services for school psychological services, including counseling and evaluations. Those are $2,005 dollars. It's now 2013, and with the downturn in the economy, in addition to the provisions in the Affordable Care Act of 2010, Medicaid is going to be more available to a higher number of students, particularly in Newburgh. We have many Medicaid-eligible students, and given those two examples I just gave you, I would argue that we have far more students now than we did back in 2005. We could potentially recoup these dollars if we can get our licensure passed. I'm asking you as a school board and the central administration to make your voices heard in Albany, along with NIASC's voice, so that we can obtain the over $100 million left on the table in New York State because school psychologists are no longer Medicaid reimbursable. I have some paperwork here. There's a letter of support that I'm getting old, I can't read the headings. The New York State School Boards Association has endorsed our licensure legislation. The New York Association of School Business Officials and the New York State Alliance for Children with Special Needs, as well as the Council for School Superintendents. So I'm going to give you this information. There's also some information here on mental health services for students. Given what happened in Newtown and the dire mental health needs of our students here in Newburgh, I think that it's imperative that we pursue any kind of supports we can for the students in this district. So I'm asking for your help to partner with us so that we can obtain these funds.
Absolutely, Ms. Cassie.
Ms. Romney, could you just grab that from her? And you can provide that to Mr. McCoy. I'm sorry. And go ahead. And I wanted to say something else. Go ahead.
I just wanted to let you know, Ms. Cassie, also that I would say every 4 to 6 weeks I travel to Albany in lobbying efforts on behalf of our school district. And certainly this is something I'll be going in March for a conference, and certainly something that I will be speaking to our legislators and senators and so on about. So I will provide that to all of the board members, but I certainly will be bringing that with me when I go and speak with them next month. Mr. Casella.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Casey. As you may or may not know, annually there's required personnel that has to go to mandated Medicaid training. Myself am included, along with the special ed personnel that handle direct care of the Medicaid services. A couple of years ago, New York State was sued by the government because of the Medicaid reporting that wasn't done right, and thus have taken aid back, what's called the FMAP, the Federal Medicaid Assistance Plan. They've taken aid away from the state, from the school district, because we were reporting all of those, including transportation for those that necessary, and all social services that we're doing. The psychological services, the social work services, we still maintain records on those, and when we're eligible to report them, they'll go in so we can reap the aid. And I echo your sentiments. I too lobby hard to try to get this, because the school districts did what we were supposed to do according to the state, and the state didn't read the regs right in the federal guidelines, so they've passed the penalty along to us. So we are on top of the Medicaid reporting. We do recover some of the aid. It's not as much as we were experiencing back when the federal Medicaid money was coming. So we'll continue our efforts. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ms. Fuller. I didn't really intend to come here to speak, but I'm glad I did. I just want to echo what the ones that were speaking about Horizon. And I urge you to please to not close Horizon. It is an inner city school. I believe in inner city schools. And if there is a decision to close Horizon, I would appreciate, the community will appreciate, and I will let them be aware that this is something that was discussed, because Horizon on Hudson needs to stay in the inner city, and we need to stop busing our children in the inner city out to the suburbs. What needs to happen is we need to have fair access and equal and fair resources and asset and access to resources in our inner city schools. Thank you.
Thank you. Other suggestions? All right, then if there's no other suggestions for this evening, I'll just remind everyone that the board meeting is Tuesday, the 26th at 7 p.m. It will be held at Temple Hill School. And our next budget workshop will be on March 7th, 6 to 8 p.m. And that will be held at Meadow Hill School. Thank you all for attending this evening, and thank you very much for your input.